1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends. And I can't wait to get on the road again.
Fixing to start some more doings here, I think. It's up to you.
No.
I think I first ought to say this. I was coming from the Smoky Mountains, and I went to the airport to catch the plane. I was dressed just pretty much how I am today in the airport, and I went to the restaurant to eat breakfast. And I sit down, and the waitress came and started taking the order. When she finished, she said, "Sir, you're from Texas, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes, I am. How do you know?" And she said, "Well, because of your accent." Now, I tell you this because if you do not understand every word I say because of my accent, forget about it. Because someday when we get to heaven, everybody's gonna speak Spanish. Okay. Now, tonight is a very special night for me anyway. I got home and this happened about, 2 weeks ago or so, about 8:30, and my wife was waiting for me at the door. "Come on in, I have something to show you." She was so excited. And I kept saying, "Well, what is it, what is it?" And she said, "Just come on, come on, come on." And she took me to our little office at the house, and she turned the computer on. And she said, and I said, "What is it, what is it?" Just a minute, you'll see it. Pretty soon it came on. And it was the cattle drive in Brownwood. And we just sat there and watched it. And I said, "This is wonderful, this is beautiful. We can watch the whole thing." When we finished, I said, "Can we play it again?" And we saw it again, and I saw Mr. Wilson there talking. And there was a time where he got a little emotional talking about the old times. Well, he made me emotional. And so I said, "I got to find this man." So I went to the computer and Googled his name, and there was a lot of Wilsons in Brownwood. And the first number I called, I said, "Sir, can you help me? I'm trying to find a gentleman by the name, his last name is Wilson, and he does a cattle drive in Brownwood." "Oh, that's my dad." Yes, right off the bat. And so he said, "He's not here now, but he'll be in a little bit later. Give me your phone number and he'll call you." Well, we got together, and so I said, "Sir, my name is Ido Ortiz, and I just saw a clip from your cattle drive, and I think it's beautiful." Anyway, I asked him, you know, "What do I have to do to participate in this cattle drive?" Well, he misunderstood me. He thought that I wanted to see the cattle drive. And he said, "I tell you where you can park your car and you can see." And I said, no, I want to be a part of it." And he said, "Well, that's wonderful." Yeah, and I said, "When is it going to happen?" I asked him, and he said, "Well, I really don't know yet, but I'll call you and I'll let you know when." Well, we left it at that, but I kept thinking about the cattle drive. This is a dream that I've had all my life, you know, cattle drive. Anyway, thinking, I decided, "Hey, I'm going to invite these friends. I'm going to ask Mr. Wilson if he lets me have breakfast before the cattle drive. And I bring the guys with the chat wagon, and we just have breakfast and then do the cattle drive." And he said, "That is wonderful. Let's do it." He was so excited. Well, we still did not have a date. But and then I called him again and said, I've been thinking, what about Saturday night? Can we do something on Saturday night? And I have a friend that is a cowboy singer, and he's been in different countries, and he's a good friend of mine. What about invite some of your friends, and we'll have him sing and play the guitar and sit by the fire? And he said, that is beautiful. That is wonderful. Let's do it. Well, we set a date, and it's today. So I am so thankful that Mr. Wilson was so kind to give us the opportunity to enjoy this event. When I was growing up in Colombia, that's coming to America was kind of a dream that it could happen, it could not. But my mother one day woke me up from my dream when she said, son, we decided to send you to the United States. Your sister is getting married and we want you to give her away, and because it's too expensive for all of us to travel. So we'd like for you to go. And I said, mother, are you sure what you're saying? Am I going to Texas? Well, son, yes. And I said, you know, mother, this calls for a celebration. I've been wanting to go to Texas. And so I ran to the kitchen because I knew that in the kitchen, she had all the things that she needed for cooking. And she kept a bottle of wine there in the pantry. And when she was cooking a cake or whatever, she put a little bit of wine on the food. And I wanted to celebrate, so I got the bottle of wine while she was screaming at me, no, no, no. And I put as much wine in my mouth that I could hold, and then I swallowed it. I did that twice. And so we sat at the table, and she kept telling me about the trip. She said, son, if you go to America, if you like it, you can stay. If you don't, just come back home. And I said, mother, that was 15 minutes later. Mother, am I going to Texas? And she said, son, you're not going to Texas. They're not going to let you on the plane like you are. And I said, mother, I'm not going to fly. I'm going to swim to Texas. And she said, you better go take a cold shower before your daddy get home, because you're not going anywhere. Well, the trip to the United States was a dream. And one of the things about my generation in Colombia was that Texas was the United States, and the United States was Texas. That's how famous Texas is all over the world. No matter where you go, if you go dressed like I am right now, they pick you up from the crowd. That's a cowboy from Texas. And they want to take a picture with you. Clayton, the singer, he can tell you more about it. He's been in other countries. But anyway, when I got to Texas, there was so many things to see, new culture, new language. When I got here, I did not know any English, but it took some time, and I began to get adjusted to the culture of the American people. And if you were to ask me, what was your first impression when you got to America? What impressed you the most? Can you tell me in one word what it was? It's not very hard, because the first impression, and to say it in one word, it would be the courtesy of the American people. It started in the airport. When I got off the plane and went to the immigration office, I handed the officer my passport. He opened it up, looked at me, signed it, put a rubber stamp, and handed it to me, and he said, welcome to the United States of America, young man.
Yay.
Those words were carved in my heart. From there on, I said, this is the place where my future is. I began to love the United States, admire the United States, and respect the United States. So thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to be here with you and enjoy this culture that is so loved all over the world. So now I'm going to ask the cooks, Boogie Red, and then your friends, they can come and they're going, each of them gonna speak just a little bit to tell you why they do this, how they do this. It is so special that I had the opportunity to meet them. They've been in my place and we had friends. They also been to our church. They perform the same. And I'll take them everywhere I can because I really enjoy the way they do their ministry.
Where do you live now?
I live in Keene, between Keene and Cleveland. We have a little house there.
Okay. I'm Booger. This is Tex. That's Slim. We got started this several years ago. Me and my wife, I don't know how many of you heard the Red Steagle ride. It's a 100-mile, 5-day wagon train ride. And we done it with borrowed horses, borrowed wagon, borrowed harness. It was a rodeo every morning. We went through rope and duct tape, keep the harness together, the wagon coming apart. The outriders ride by, if you look down, you shake their heads. But we laughed, we cried. We got through with that, we got home. I told her, I said, you know what? We're going back again next year. We're going back for our own rig. It won't be the best one there, but it's not going to be the worst one anymore. And she said, what are you going to do? I said, we're buying us a wagon, team of horses, horse trade living quarters each stand, a new pickup to pull it with. And she said, my gosh, that's going to be a lot of money. I said, yeah, it is. She said, where are you going to get it? I said, we're going to take it out of retirement. She said, before you take that kind of money out of retirement, you need to pray about it. And we need to pray about it and make sure it's what God wants you to do. And I said, I'll agree with you. So we prayed. She said, I'm praying for a sign, something like a wagon or something. I said, okay. So they called us, wanting us to cook for a cowboy gathering at cowboy churches. And I told them, we can't do it. We just got through this Red Steagle ride. We're gill out. He said, okay. So we'll find somebody else. So went on 3 or 4 days. He called back. He said, we can't find nobody else and we're running out of time. I said, well, we've had a little rest. We'll cook for us. We went and cooked. We cleaned up the dishes, cleaned up the meal after lunch one day, and a bunch of cowboys sitting there, and we're talking, something came up about a Red Steagle ride. Guy writing on a piece of paper, and he handed me the paper, and it said, Impact Cowboy Church, Nacogdoches, Stan King, Pastor. Red and green wagon, team of Welsh cob horses, and brand new harness. I said, what are you asking for? He said, we're giving them to you.
Oh.
Well, my wife started crying. She said, all I prayed for was a wagon. We went to pick them up, and just like you said, it was beautiful horses, nice wagon. Matter of fact, it's the first Chucky wagon out there. And we was picking them up, and the guy went with me to haul the horses back, and I was hauling the wagon back. He said, I can't believe y'all gave this stuff away. He said, I can't either, but I was sitting there, and God touched my heart. I didn't have no choice.
Uh-huh.
We got back. I told my wife, I said, this can't be a Chuck wagon trail ride wagon. It's got to be a ministry.
That's right.
And that's how we started out with the Chuck wagon ministry.
Amen.
I'm Tex. The real name, you don't want to know. Okay. You couldn't remember it anyway, and that's why I just go with Tex. I was born in Switzerland, over in Europe, in the middle of World War II. I remember some of the first years of my life was in the war. And growing up with my brother, who was 2 years older than I am, we loved cowboys. We loved the West, Indians, anything that we could read or see in magazines or on the radio that had to do with the Wild West. We were just, you know, really in awe of that country. But I knew that the Wild West was in Texas. And Texas was about as hard to get to and about as far away as heaven is. That's all we thought. Well, here I am. You know, I never thought that as a 5-year-old boy that I would ever be able to live my dream. And back in 93, we came to Texas after moving throughout the United States with my wife and all that, mostly job related. Finally, the job got us to Texas. And I told my wife, woman, I'm hanging up my hat. And we've been there in the same house for about 24 years now, and we love every minute She is an Eskimo girl from Wisconsin. She does not like the heat. She would love it out there. I'm cold. Switzerland is a cold country. Why do you think I left there? So, I am very happy to be here with you all, and just thank you for your hospitality. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, I'm the quiet one. I don't have much to say, but I love what we do, and I'm just glad to be here with you folks tonight, enjoying this time together.
Thank you.
Another thing I want to relate a story that concerned Edo at the first time we met him. They've got a little church down between Meridian and Clifton. They have a church service one Saturday a year, and he wanted to bring the chuck wagons down there. Well, we go down there, and he said, I want you to come in and give a report just like it's 1880. So I go in that church and tell him, I said, we left Uvalde 3 months ago with 3,000 head of cattle. I got 60 drovers, 20 wranglers, 200 head of horses. I said, it took us 3 days to cross the Brazos River. I said, but the grasses are good here, the water's so good, hospitality is wonderful, we're just going to stay here 2 or 3 days and let the cattle freshen up. Mm-hmm. We go back out the wagon, here this little old lady comes out there. She said, where's all them cows at? I said, ma'am, there's no cows here. She said, you mean you stood in that church and lied to us?
I remember that. I never thought in my life that I was going to introduce a real cowboy. You know, the cowboy culture is so famous around the world. And that was one of my dreams, is to meet a real Texas cowboy. And I was in the dorm in Keene going to school. And so I began to speak a little bit of English. So I asked, where would be a place to see a real Texas cowboy? Well, go to the barn sale, where they sell cows in Cleburne. So I went there, and sure enough, there were all kinds of cowboys there. And they have a platform where you walk kind of high, and then you look down on the cattle that are for sale, and you pick up a number of the ones that you're going to bid on. And I was walking in what they call
catwalk.
That's it, a catwalk. That's right. I was walking, and I detected this guy. He was a real cowboy, but I was looking at his back, and he had spurs, boots, I mean, the whole gear, a perfect cowboy. And I could see his banana legs from distance, and I knew that he'd been hugging that horse for a long time. And so, then he turned around, and then I could not figure out why he looked like that. And I kind of felt sorry for the guy. I thought he had been a dentist, and maybe he had a root canal, and they put a cotton ball in his mouth, you know.
That's cavity.
I kept looking at him, and then... I never asked him, what happened with you? What happened? I just looked at him. I knew that he can speak very clear. And then I went to the rodeo in Cleburne, and everybody had gone to the dentist. I had never seen so many people spitting at the same time. I mean, some of those cowboys were really good. They could hit a flight in midair. And then came the opportunity to ask this cowboy about his horse. I did get to talk to him. And he said, you see that red, kind of reddish horse over there? And he said, and I said, well, that's a pretty horse. Yeah, and he said, that's a green horse. It was just as brown as it could be, and he said, it's a green horse. And I said, this guy might be colorblind. And so finally I said, what do you mean that's a green horse? This is brown as it could be. And he said, if you get in that horse, he's gonna bite you so hard your hair is gonna fall. And I said, well, that's what a green horse is. He said, yeah, that's a green horse. You cannot ride him and enjoy it. Yeah, I mean, you gotta hang on to him. Well, anyway, I learned what a green horse was that day. But and then coming back to our friend Clayton Reed, I've known him for almost 60 years. And he used to teach my boys guitar lessons when they were young. Anyway, it's really a pleasure to have Clayton with us. And he's going to sing one song, and then we're going to have another thing, and then he's going to come back and sing another, and maybe we'll keep hearing him the rest of the evening. Come on, Clayton.
I'm glad to be here too, you know. Uh-huh. Springtime in Texas, you just never know what's going to happen. But this first one, Farther Along, I would like to dedicate to A.J. Pallmeyer. Tempted and tried, we're oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never more or less good, though in the wrong. Farther along we'll know all about it. Farther along we understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by.
You know, there is a phrase here in America that is known all over the world, and that phrase is the American dream. Everybody knows what the American is, the American dream. You know that the United States is the only country in the world that can say that phrase. You don't hear Colombian dream, or Argentina dream, or France dream. Is always the American dream. Well, one other thing that is interesting about the United States is the meaning that the United States has for the word success. And I learned that after a few years here in America, and getting involved in the culture. That in America, the word success is when you are in a position when you can give an opportunity to somebody else.
That's it.
Mr. Wilson gave me an opportunity to be here with you. That is success. And so interested about this word, success, that it's contagious. If you are given an opportunity, you're ready to give somebody else an opportunity. That is a principle that is biblical in a way, and this is why the United States is the most successful to have the best American dream anybody can have. So I'd like to introduce to you my American dream. Wife. So she is going to give the portion of it tonight.
Well, if he's going to sit down, I'm going to sit down. Is that okay?
You bet.
Well, after that, I'm kind of anxious to hear what I have to say. I, too, want to express my gratitude for the opportunity to be here tonight. Actually, Ito was in Colombia when I happened to see this video. It was on Facebook, and one of our friends had posted it, and I watched it, and I, too, became so emotional about it because we had just... Well, we live on a little ranch, and we've got some longhorns that we've just gotten. And so I knew that when Ito saw that, I knew exactly what he was going to say. And guess what? He said, I have to meet that man. And so for us to be sitting here tonight is such an awesome opportunity, and we are feel very blessed that we could be among all of you. I know all of you know each other, and we're kind of the odd ones out, but we feel like, you know, we're all a community. So what I had planned to say, I was thinking that we would be outside and it would be difficult to hear. I'm glad I have a mic because I kind of have a soft voice. And so I was going to tell you this little story. A few years ago, my son called me and said, guess what? I'm getting married. Well, he was the last of all the cousins and the grandsons and all to make this announcement. And so everyone was kind of waiting for this to happen. So he lives in Maryland, so he had told me, he said, next family gathering in Texas, well, you can tell them. So the time came, and we had our gathering, and I was like, okay. It was very noisy. It was a room full of this many people plus many little children, and it was very noisy. And so... at one point, I decided I'm just going to have to raise my voice and make myself known. So I was trying to talk above the crowd and projecting my voice, and I think, you know, all the little nieces and nephews and all probably had never heard me talk that way. So anyway, I got finished, and before anyone could say anything, my three-year-old nephew goes, amen! And we all burst out laughing. He probably thought I was preaching. And so he probably had no idea what I was saying. But I tell you that tonight because I hope the thoughts that I have for you tonight, you can say in your heart, amen, and that it will stick with you throughout the coming days. So when Ito asked me to give the devotional for the Cowboys, I'm like, why me? I'm a city girl. I'm a cowgirl by marriage. And it's kind of a dream that I've always had too. I had never been around animals very much as a child growing up, but I always had a dream of being around animals. I love animals. So I married a cowboy, and unfortunately, we've only been married 21 years. Probably if it had been longer, I would be a true cowgirl. But anyway, as I was thinking about the culture of the cowboys and what could I bring as a city girl, you know, down deep in my heart, I pondered that question over and over, and you know, actually a lot of things came to my mind. But then I thought, you know, there is one thing that all human nature needs, and that is eternity. And so tonight I want to talk to you just briefly about that. It all came to me as I was thinking about what I might say. Many things came into my head, but nothing was gelling. And so even this morning, I wasn't quite sure what it was going to be. And then all of a sudden, I had just been praying, you know, what, Lord, would be the best thing for my friends to hear? And all of a sudden, it came in my head, something that my father had taught me. And my father was a minister, and he was a very kind man, and he loved people. And I just remember him telling me one thing. He told me many things, but this really stuck in my mind. He said, always look to Jesus. Now, he told me that when I was just in grade school. And throughout my life, I saw him practice that. And it has shaped my life in many ways. It has helped me to not become a bitter person. We all go through difficult things. But the most important thing that we can do is to look to Jesus, because people will disappoint you. I don't care who it is, they will disappoint you. You will disappoint yourself. And I've done that many times too. But even in those instances, the mantra that stays in my mind is look to Jesus, because he will be the answer for everything that you go through in life.
Amen.
So as we think about this tonight as cowboys, I was also thinking how, you know, we look to Jesus. He's our leader. He's our guide. Well, in the cowboy world, when you're on a cattle drive, we have the trail boss here, and he's our leader. So the cattle and the cowboys are going to follow the leader, the trail boss. And if you don't follow the trail boss, if you get sidetracked, if you stray, you're not going to make it. I remember in the video that he made, he said, I want to get every cow there that leaves my place. I want them to get to the other place. That is his goal. That's Jesus's goal for us. He doesn't want one of us to not make it to the promised land.
Amen.
And the choice is ours. We have to be the one that makes the decision. And the only way that we can do that is if we look to Jesus. So in John, I think it's 14:6, it says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And so that is a reminder to us that our everyday life, no matter what we're going through, that if we look to Jesus, he will always show us the way and we can make it to the promised land. So I would like for us to just sing the little chorus, turn your eyes upon Jesus, and then I'll have a prayer.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his
loving Father in heaven. What an honor and a privilege it is to be here among your people. Lord, we're so grateful for each life here and each family represented. And Lord, tonight as we come together in this special celebration, we ask for your guidance, we ask for your leadership, and we are telling you that we want to follow you. Lord, I pray tomorrow that as the cattle drive gets started and goes throughout the day, that you will lay your protecting hand upon all those who are participating. I pray, Lord, that each cow will make it to the destination, to the promised land where the grass is green and they can eat their fill. And Lord, as the cowboys are doing their work tomorrow, remind them that they are on their way to the promised land too, and that if we keep our eyes on you, we will make it. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm grateful that Jesus saved me, and I know that he's going to have a word or two about how busy I've kept his guardian angels. Because if I die tomorrow falling off my horse, which I'm very grateful to get down here and be able to ride, I would have lived three or four lifetimes by anybody's standard. And the thought that I would like you to remember that I mean from my heart is that all over the world, as I've sung these old songs that mean so much to us, especially to this group, it's not the fancy palaces, it's not the big houses, it's not the courtyards. It's the people that I remember. The people that took time to share their memories and their dreams of what it really is like to live in Texas. And, you know, I tell them, well, it does rain and the wind blows hard and it's dusty, but I wouldn't want to be anywhere else, and I have truly been all over the world. I'm going to do a little set. It's a fairly short set. But it's based on a song, and it's called The Cowboy Song. And it was written by a guy named Roy Robison. And if any of y'all spend any time hanging around the north side of Fort Worth, he went by the stage name of Amos Staggs. And I'm going to sing this song, and then I'm going to sing the songs that the song talks about. Pushing horns weren't easy, like the movie said it was. Don't remember dance hall girls, the hotel rooms and rugs. You worked hot and tired and nasty, and rode your pony's head too low. Cause all those nights you couldn't sleep, it was too damn cold. You'd sing Strawberry Roan and Little Joe. By the time we hit the river and the rain begin to fall, the water's rising so darn fast we thought it'd drown us all. We lost a lot of steers that night, four or five good mounts. And all the boys rode into camp. We knew that what counts. And we sang Yippee-ki-yay in Amazing Grace. Oh, the night that broke behind us and the rain began to fall. I whistled out the Bonner. I seen the terror in his eyes. He rode for all his horse would ride, and I know he'd done his best. But he crossed over Jordan, riding Dunny to his death. And we sang, bringing in the sheaves and the rugged cross. So when you see the cowboy, he's not ragged by his choice. He never meant to bow them legs or put that gravel in his voice. He's just chasing what he really loves, what's burning in his soul, wishing that he'd been born 100 years ago. Still singing Strawberry Road and Little Joe. Still singing Strawberry Road. Still learning how to use my glasses. Oh, wait a minute. Getting this thing at the right. Thank you so much. Job again, not earning it now. The fellow steps up and he says, I suppose you're a bronc rider by the looks of your clothes. Well, you figures me right, and I'm a good one, I claim. Do you happen to have any bad ones to tame? Said, I got a bad one to buck. Throw with good riders, he's had lots of luck. Well, I gets all head up. And I asked what he'd pay to just ride this old man for a couple of days. He offers me 10 and I says, I'm your man. The buck ain't alive that I cannot fend. Well, he says, get your saddle. I'm going to give you a chance. We hops in his buckboard and rides to the ranch. I says, till morning, then ride after Chuck. Steps out to see if this outlaw can buck. Down in the horse corral, standing alone, stood an old Kyle, Strawberry Road. His legs were all spavined, and he had pigeon toes, with pig eyes and a big Roman nose. Little pin ears what touched at the tips. A big 44 brand was on his left hip. He was u-necked and all with a long low jaw. I could see with one eye, he's a regular outlaw. Well, I get some blinds on him, but sure is a fight. Next comes the saddle and I screws her down tight. I steps up on him and raises the blind. Get out the way, boys, he's gonna unwind. Sure as a frog walker, he heed the big size. He only lacked wings but to be on the fly. Turned his old belly right up to the sun. Sure was a sunfishing son of a gun. He's about the worst bucker I've seen on the range. He could turn on one nickel and give you back change. He goes down on the floor and he goes up on high. Leaves me a spinning up there in the sky. Well, it turns over twice now. Comes back to earth and I'm sitting there cussing the day of his birth. Cause I know there's ponies that I cannot write. Some of them left Lord, have them all died. Well, I bet my last dollar that the man ain't alive that can stay on strawberry when he makes his hide dive. Oh, that strawberry road. Oh, that strawberry road. Never a horse that couldn't be rode. Never a cowboy that couldn't be thrown. Try to ride that old strawberry road. Try to ride that old strawberry
road. On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. Is making music with my friends, and I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again, going places that I've never been, seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again.